10 years old. I remember thinking how cool it would be when we were going on an 8-hour drive. If I could just watch TV. Given anything to have my own Pac-Man game at home. Now I've got it on my phone. Hey, glory, glory, hallelujah. Welcome to the future. My grandpa was in World War II. He fought against the Japanese. He wrote 100 letters to my grandma.
Director of Reach, one of our mission partners, and he's here to preach this morning. And we're really glad to have him and his wife Bonnie with us as we get started. I have a couple of announcements that I want to share. There's a lot going on, so I encourage you to take some time, read through the bulletin. And first of all, I want to say thanks to everybody who helped with the Interfaith Hospitality Network. We hosted the homeless this week. Had a really wonderful family join us. A couple of wonderful families, I should say. And I'm sure that there may be some laundry. Usually there's some laundry over in the other building outside the sanctuary. If you want to pick up a bag of laundry, take it with you. Take it home and wash it. Bring it back to the office. That helps us to get ready for next time. So I hope that you'll take advantage of that one last opportunity to serve. I want to share with you an announcement about our special church conference, or our annual church conference, I should say. It's coming up. It's going to be taking place next Saturday at the Calvary Korean Church in East Brunswick. Now you say, why would we have a conference for our local church in East Brunswick? Well, the reason is because one of the things that we've tried to do over the past couple of years is make this more of an event where we gather a whole lot of churches, a whole lot of people. We bring in a speaker, and actually it's really a great day of worship and a great day of learning. So we encourage all of our members to come and join us. Again, it's going to be in East Brunswick at 10 o'clock is our meeting next Saturday. And then it'll be followed by worship and a time with Rachel Billups, who is the pastor at Ginghamsburg United Methodist Church. So I look forward to hearing what she has to say. And if you'd like to come join us, please send an email to the church office. We'll coordinate and carpool. But it's good for us to know who's planning to go so that we can coordinate that. The United Methodist Women are having a trivia night. If you're looking for something to do next Saturday night, they would love to have you come and join them. You can get your team together, and that's been a fun event for them. And finally, I want to share just a word about next Sunday. What we're going to be doing is we're going to be having an intergenerational worship event, kind of like what we did a month ago. And that was a great success. We had a lot of fun, and we're going to be doing it again on this coming Sunday for All Saints Day. And so we invite you to come and bring your whole family. We're not going to be having Sunday school, but we're inviting everybody to come and join us here on Sunday morning at 9:30. And so we welcome all of you along with your families. And then finally, I do want to share one piece. Many of you probably saw the email that I sent out late last week talking about our special session of annual conference that was to take place yesterday. And so we had a meeting yesterday. Some of you were there and joined us. And I would just want to share a little bit of the outcome of that meeting. And I have a little script here, so I'm just going to, if you don't mind, I'm just going to read off the script because I don't want to get too far away from it this morning. So I certainly don't want to take away from Tim this morning, but I wanted to share a little bit. That special session was convened to deal with the report that was coming from the conference team on the way forward. And in short, what we did yesterday was we did vote to adopt their recommendations. And one of the things that they recommended was that we would create space for pastors and churches to be able to do ministry with the LGBTQ plus community according to their conscience. And that means including celebrating weddings. It does not, the commission's recommendations do not require anything of churches that don't feel called to do that ministry. But for those who do feel called to that ministry, it creates a pathway for them to create a covenant whereby they could do that. In addition, our bishop yesterday in his Episcopal address shared that he would not pursue charges against LGBTQ plus clergy and would not pursue charges against pastors who celebrate same-sex weddings. So this was a very significant announcement from our bishop yesterday. Now, that address is going to be available actually now online if you'd like to take a look at it. And so it was shared yesterday on our Facebook page. You can take a look at our Facebook page. It's on my personal Facebook page. Now, there's more to be said about what we did and probably what's going to flow out of that. But I will put together something today, tomorrow, and we'll put that into the newsletter, and you can get kind of a fuller report that'll come out in the newsletter this week. But in the meantime, let me say this. I know that there are many of you who will welcome this news, and I, you know, personally, I welcome this news. There are others who can be frustrated by it. And I already had some of those conversations already this morning. There will be others who say, well, it doesn't go far enough. In other words, we're still kind of, you know, in the same place we were with respect to the denomination. And all those things are true. And there are going to be some churches for whom, when this is shared this morning, are going to have, there's going to be a very different reaction to what I just shared. So I encourage you to continue to be in prayer for our annual conference, for the United Methodist Church, for our local church, for our bishop, for our superintendent. I'm sure the bishop is going to, his inbox is going to be full to overflowing and then some over the next days and weeks. But this is uncharted territory. You know, it really is. And so I just encourage you to be in prayer for all of us. And with that said, I think I'm going to turn it over to Nate and to lead us in worship. And so let's go.
Let's do it. Thanks, Joe. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to our time of worship. We're excited to worship with you this morning amidst the rain. So let's shake that off. I invite you to stand as you're able, and we'll sing a few songs together. Amen.
He has the wrong one up.
Oh. This is actually Glory to God. P.S.
Generation, we're making loud our freedom.
love of the world in motion. God above all my hopes and fears. I don't care what the world throws at me now. Gonna be alright, cause I know.
Peace with one another. So let's go ahead and do that. Got one more for you. This is called More Than Amazing.
The one who walked on water, and you calm the raging seas. You command the highest mountains to fall upon their knees. You're the one who welcomes sinners, and you open blinded eyes. You restore the brokenhearted. brought the dead to life, forgetting all our sin. You remember with authority. You've spoken, and you set the captives free. You're the King who came to serve, and you're the God who washed our feet. You're the one who took our burden, and you bled upon the cross. In your kindness and your mercy, you became the way.
Thank you. So again, good morning, everyone. In just a minute, our ushers are going to come around. They have the red attendance pads. And when they come around, I hope that you'll take some time. Let us know that you've been here. And especially if you're visiting with us for the first time, I want to say thank you for being here. I hope that you'll share with us your contact information at the bottom of the page so that we can let you know about things that are going on here at the church. We have a weekly newsletter, a monthly newsletter that we send out. And that'll give us an opportunity to connect with you. And we hope to be able to do that in a personal way as time goes on. So today, you know, we have this great privilege to welcome Tim Dayton, who's the executive director of Reach, and also the pastor of First Christian Church, which is a Disciples of Christ congregation in Roanoke, Virginia. And our congregation has been partnered with Reach now for 9 years, and this year is going to be our 10th year serving at Reach. And so we're really excited to continue this partnership that we've had over these past 10 years, and excited too for the growth in Reach's ministry, for their work in the community in Southeast Roanoke. They've expanded kind of beyond the normal church group mission trip kind of clientele, you know, people coming in really to touch. Young people are coming for spring break and having alternative spring break experiences, also with corporate groups who have come to serve. So the number of people who are being impacted and the level of impact over these past few years has continued to grow. And so I'm really excited to have Tim here. We're going to invite Donna to come and read the scripture, and then the next voice that you'll hear after that will be Tim's. And we're grateful that he's here. I'm grateful for his friendship, and it's always good to have you with us. Only be a little a minute, ma'am.
It's very, very short today. Good morning. Don't cry. All right, today's scripture is from James 1, verses 1 through 2. James, a servant of God and of our Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes scattered among the nations, greetings. Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Trials
Amen.
Of many kinds.
Trials of many kinds.
Good morning.
Say hi.
Oh, no, that now. Okay, good. All done. Yeah, perfect.
I believe I'm on. Is my mic? Okay, it is on. I fell twice this morning in the other service because I'm not used to your steps. It's a wonder to me that Joe gets to, or Kathy went, Kathleen?
I answered either.
Okay. When they preach that they do it three times, because I don't know how on earth you do the same thing again, because hopefully I will use some of the same material. The first thing I want to say is the first several years that I've come here, and we couldn't figure out how many times that I've preached here, I did feel always extremely welcome. But this is the first year when I feel like I'm like one of you. I feel like I'm just among friends, and I'm coming to talk. And that is my style as a pastor. So I thank you for the fact that we have this relationship that really feels like that great friend that you can see once a year, and they don't say, where have you been? They say, good to see you. What's up? What's been happening in the last year? So thanks for that. A couple other things. Joe has been telling me for years that anytime I need anything from Medford, that they're going to be here. And I finally figured out, and so I'm going to call that one in. He said anything. And so, Nate, the praise band, starts June 7th. And you guys, you don't have to stay about 7 weeks. And if it's easier for you, you can just do three nights a week and come home. So thank you, Joe, for that. He did not put any qualifiers on that. Having been here, I also realize that we take things for granted. And I cannot take for granted that those of you even know who I am or what Reach is and what we do. And so I'm going to take the first 2 minutes, and it's important for my message, to share with you what in the nonprofit world we call our elevator speech. It's like, you're only going to give me 2 minutes. I got to somehow tell you something that lets you know who we are. And that's very important because one of the things we believe in Reach is you don't know somebody till you know their story. When I tell you the things that I'm going to share with you today, you need to know from whence I came, what the perspective is. So that's real important. So as Joe said, I make a living as a pastor. The First Christian Church pays me to be their pastor. And because of that, I am the volunteer, just like you guys that come down to us, I'm the volunteer executive director of the Impact Organization Reach. It's really a nonprofit, but the word nonprofit has become to mean, you know, people that don't make money and don't do much. And we do a lot, and we still don't make money. It's an impact. We make an impact in the area. It's an impact organization. We started, and REACH stands for Real Experiences Affecting Change. We started almost 10 years ago. Medford has been, for all intents and purposes, a founding member because your youth group I had met the year previous to starting REACH, and realized that there were groups like yours that went away on these mission trips that were looking for something more, something deeper. And I don't mean necessarily deeper spiritually, because most of those groups are wonderful spiritually, but deeper in the difference and the connection they make in the community. So that's who we are, what we are. That's what we are and who I am. How we do what we do is we connect and engage individuals and groups in a positive service experience. What a positive service experience is when you see a need and you meet that need. So it's my understanding that this past weekend you guys were hosting the Interfaith Hospitality Network, which I didn't realize that was the name. I helped start the Interfaith Hospitality Network in Roanoke 25 years ago. It is an absolutely awesome ministry. But that's what I'm talking about. You see a need. People needed a place to stay. And you meet that need. You give them a place to stay. They needed meals, and you gave them meals. So a positive service experience is one where you actually see the need and you meet the need. So that's what we do. We go out there, and we connect and engage in positive service experience. What it looks like from the outside is if we reclaim abandoned homes, we clean rivers, we work at a homeless shelter, we collect food and distribute food. It looks like that from the outside, but those are just tools to us. So that's what we do. How we do it is we partner, collaborate, and cooperate with other churches like yours, other civic and community groups, the Roanoke City government, corporations, colleges. And here I'm going to throw one that I didn't tell Joe. We do bring the corporations and the colleges and that in. We're starting a new one. And I understand from my own children, last one just got married, I understand that a thing that young people do now is they go on these bachelor and bachelorette parties where they actually go away for an entire weekend. And it's getting harder and harder to top the next one. You know, let's go to the Bahamas, let's go to Bermuda, whatever it is that you do. And so we have the answer to that. We are now starting a group where you come in and you get to eat really well at night and you can have wine and beer, whatever you want. But during the day, you're going to go out and work at the homeless shelter, or you're going to clean a river, or you're going to work at the rescue mission. So you're actually, when you get back at that night, when you go to talk about what did you do all day, it's not like, oh, I was at the beach and I saw this or that, or I swam. It's like, oh, did you see those people we met? Did you see how did it feel when we were feeding people that needed food, or we made a difference in the world, and so we found a new way to take advantage of what you all do. So is anybody getting married soon, need a bachelor or bachelorette party? I'll do it for free for you guys. So any of you want to get married again or pretend, we'll set up your bachelor or bachelorette party. So that's what we do. We connect, or we work in partnership with groups that are already out there, because there's plenty of fine groups like Interfaith that do a wonderful ministry. Why create it? Why not just be part of the team? So that's how we do it. The why is the most important thing to us. We believe that the only sustainable way you can transform this world, and the world is in deep need of some sort of transformation. I don't, you know, what issue you want to talk about or which side you want to take, the world is in need of transformation, is that you need to involve the people that are already there using the assets that are already available to them. And again, Interfaith Hospitality is a great example of that. You're already here. They already have a need. You have this wonderful asset. This is the kind of thing you can do again and again and again without a whole lot of headache and heartache. You don't have to recreate, spend all that energy and time, and which is just incredible. So we just partner and help other groups that are out there. What I need you to understand, and the reason I picked that scripture, is more because of the book than it is because of the two verses. I tell my congregation all the time that you should never take a verse or two out of context. So I'm going to put it into context for you, and I'm also going to give you a plug because I'm going to start following it. I understand you have a podcast now on the book of James. And it's an app. It's an app. So if you haven't done that, I personally believe the book of James, it is my rock. It is my foundation for who I am and what I do. It took me a while to find that. James is my hero. James is my mentor. James is who I follow. But before you get off on that and say, well, you're supposed to follow Jesus, I follow James because of the way he follows Jesus, because of the way he takes the scriptures and puts them into action. He is a person who I can relate to. who I believe makes, I can understand. We as of Christians have a wonderful problem. We come on Sunday and we read the Bible and we remember Noah's Ark, because that's a fabulous story. We remember Moses and the Exodus and escaping from Egypt and wandering in the Promised Land. And we, oh, that is phenomenal. What an awesome miracle that was. We look at King David and all the things that he did, and the way that the Israelites, the Jews, progressed in the wisdom. And we are in awe of that. But we begin to think that that's what it looks like to be a Christian. Well, Tim, of course it does. Well, that's true, but that is not the only way it looks like to be a Christian. And so then we look at the Gospels and we see the miracles, and we see the miracles that Jesus did and the miracles, of course, that some of the disciples were able to do. And we think that as Christians, again, if only we could do those miracles. When I went on my first mission trip with that headset, that head idea, I took a youth group like the groups that you take, and I knew that we were going to make a huge, huge difference in this person's life. So we were escorted up to this house where this young woman lived with her two children, and there was no insulation, and the toilet flushed under the house, and there was no running hot water. And, I mean, the list went on and on and on. And I went, I need to be honest with you, I went as a savior. I had this savior complex. I had this concept that as a Christian, I'm called to do these absolutely miraculous things. And so we did. We insulated her house. We gave her hot running water. We gave her a septic tank for the toilet to flush into. And I mean, it was phenomenal what we did. And in my head, I had saved her. And in my own personal glory, by accident, I got to go back the following year. It was somewhere on the West Virginia-Tennessee border. I don't remember exactly where. And I went to go see her. If I was honest, it wasn't to go say hi and how you were doing. It was more to see my miracle. Because, obviously, life would be wonderful. And I got there and knocked on the door, and a man answered the door. And I was like, well, that's fine. You know, maybe she has a friend now or a husband or whatever. Didn't make any difference. And so I asked him about the young lady, and he said, oh, she doesn't live here anymore. Now, it's only been a year, maybe a year and a month. And I said, I don't understand. I mean, he could see the bewilderment in my face. And he goes, well, I just need to tell you, evidently last summer, some group of people came in and they fixed the insulated the walls, and the toilet now flushed into a septic system, and it had hot water, and the landlord upped the rent. And so she couldn't afford to live there anymore, and she, in essence, at least temporarily, I never did find out, I made her homeless. And I was like, whoa, wait a minute. This concept that I'm a miracle worker wasn't working. And it was frustrating, and in some ways it made me start to wonder why it is that I do what I do. And all along, James had been a very important book to me, because in James, the scripture that is the founding scripture of Reach is faith without actions is nothing. You have to do something. And I was like, well, you have to do something. But I went and studied James more, and I discovered some things that helped me to relate my faith and my humanity to what it really means to be a Christian in this world. If I'm not Noah, if I'm not King David, if I'm not Moses, if I'm not Paul, what does that even look like? And so as I began to read it, I began to try to discover a little bit about him as a person. Now James, in the book of James, theologians and historians believe he is the James that is the eldest brother, although obviously younger than Jesus, the eldest of the siblings to Jesus Christ. So it's Jesus' brother. And he appears only twice, maybe three times in the Bible, and it's just in a couple of verses, so that we know that James did exist, and he was indeed, or James was the brother of Christ. And the historians have researched in have discovered that James became a Christian after he had his first encounter with the risen Lord, and that he became a pillar of the church of Jerusalem. And so as I read James in the first two verses, it clearly tells us in his introduction to us is, I'm a servant of Jesus Christ. I'm a servant of the Lord. He's a servant. Now, if you read Paul's letters, and I love Paul and I love all that Paul did, Paul pretty much is telling you how fantastic he was and how he was chosen by Jesus to do what he did. And I think that's necessary for what Paul was doing, but that's not me. That servant part of James, that part of James where he just very matter-of-factly does what he does. So let's look back on James's life. If you had had Jesus as your brother, would have been a tough thing to live up to. Now, a lot of you have had brothers and sisters, and you had, in some cases, or you may have been that one, the good one, or the smart one, or the athletic one, and that's hard to live up to. It's hard to compete or compare with, and it's hard to take them but so seriously. And if I was James growing up with Jesus, and quite honestly, that's the way my life was, not that my brother was Jesus, but that I was hearing all these grand and glorious and wonderful things about Jesus and what it meant to be a Christian, but I was just little Timmy. And how do I live up to that? And so James, when he was confronted when Jesus appeared before him as the risen Lord, he got it. Now, not all of us have that clear experience where we feel that Jesus actually stood in front of us and spoke to us, and we're like, oh, I get it now. But everyone in this room has made a decision to try and be a Christian. You wouldn't be here if you weren't at least curious to find out what this is all about. And so James, when he got it, he didn't immediately perform a miracle and move a mountain. He didn't get on the treetops and shout out to everybody, I'm a Christian, you should be a Christian too. He immediately went to work, being who he was and where he was. So he's in Jerusalem. The disciples, for all intents and purposes, have disbanded in fear, in confusion, and there needed to be someone who got it, who was ready to live that life. And so James becomes that pillar. Now, he didn't get elected as a president or a senator or something. He didn't get anointed as king. He just was himself. He's like, oh, so that's what this is all about. This is what we're supposed to do. We're all called to be servants according to whoever it is that we are. And so he begins to bring that strength just by being himself. And some of the disciples gather, and the Jews who had accepted Jesus as their Lord gathered together and rallied around him, and they went to work trying to figure out what it meant to be a Christian. Meanwhile, Paul is out there doing his thing at first, which is not pro-Christian. He's out there, in some cases, stoning them. He's out there claiming the opposite of what it means to be a faithful Jew. He has his transformation. He realizes that Christ is the Lord. Meanwhile, James, day to day, we're not hearing a whole lot about him, is doing his thing in Jerusalem and gathering and the church in Jerusalem and doing what needs to be done and having that faith and realizing, guys, if we believe this or something, you know, we got to be there for each other. We got to, you know, there's more to it than that. And Paul comes back to Jerusalem, so the historians tell us. And the Jews are scared of him. He's different. And what the big difference is at that point is he has found a new group of people, a disenfranchised group of people, different from the Jews, who are accepting Jesus as their Savior. He is there for the Gentiles. There was a big to-do with the Jews about whether those different people, those people who do things differently, eat differently, no telling what else they do differently, how do we accept them? Or what do we even do with them? Can they be a part of our group? And James realizes Christ is here for everybody. We're called to serve. He didn't say, serve my brother, serve that person, serve this community. He said, we're servants. And so he invites Paul and his group to be a part of that church. Now, he didn't tell his group, you have to be like them. You have to, I mean, how is a Jew going to become a Gentile? You need to do the things that they do. It's just that we welcome all people. I look at your bishop right now and the huge decisions that your church has to make and how it tears us apart. And I get that. And back in that day, it tore a lot of Jews apart to think that Gentiles could be part of their new faith, their new, the Savior, the Messiah that had come. And so times don't change. But what James falls back to, and this is what Reach falls back to and does, is I'm not worried about if you're older than me or younger than me or you're a different color than me or you come from a different country or a different sexual orientation or whatever. What I believe is what James tells us in those first two verses. First and foremost, I'm called to be a servant. He doesn't have a little list of the only ones that we're going to serve are these or these are the only people that are included. We're just called to be a servant. And so James's life is, I think, an example of God telling us that we need to be who we are. I have four children. They're all different. It's absolutely wonderful. When my daughter got married 2 weeks ago, I know in her head, there's probably a part of her that wants to make her husband be a certain way or part of his head wants to make her to be a certain way. But if that marriage is going to work, they have to embrace who each other are. 4 weeks ago, my son had his first baby. First baby, you probably think that you have some kind of control on who they are and how they're going to turn out. He'll quickly realize that that's not the case. That they are going to be who they are, and he's going to need to embrace that because that's what God calls us to do. That's what James shows us works. Is that we need to be ourselves. And that we're going to make a difference. The church doesn't mean to raise up Noah and David and Moses in hopes that one of you or all of you will be of that grand and glorious, miraculous affirming Christian in this world. It's just that we like the big stories. It's not about the big stories. Years ago, I'm getting ready to show you a video. Years ago, as I, you know, you start looking at your life and what you're going to be and are you going to make a difference? And you hear about secular people. Well, a lot of them were very religious. Gandhi or Mother Teresa, or Abraham Lincoln or Thomas Edison, whatever person you want to raise up. And because somehow we feel like we can't be them, that our lives don't matter. Last night, I was given a great example of what that looks like. Do any of you follow college football or regular football? College football in particular. I'm watching football with Claire's husband, Burton, Claire Rich's husband. And I was trying to use the analogy of you have the star players, but the people on the bench are just as important. And they know that, because I would like to make a church that had that same kind of loyalty and that they would give that many hours to the church, give that many hours to the team. He goes, no, watch the people on the bench. The people on the bench, for the most part, were kind of watching the game, but they you could see them having these side conversations and every once in a while singing and doing. And so they had joined the team, but they had no expectation they were going to get on the field. And in truth, most college players, you have the starters and you have the bench warmers. Still on the team, but the bench warmers somehow know they're not going to go in, and so they're not totally engaged. I'm scared that those of us, when we get this mindset that we can't be that star, that we're no longer important. But I got to tell you, that's not the truth. We're the ones that make the biggest difference. And so I'm going to show you a video that we made for Reach that talks about the houses. We're working on two houses right now. We finished the first two. By the way, I do want to say thanks. When this building was built, Gordon Curtis kind of oversaw the project, and what he didn't want any kind of gift from you all, and so the church gave Reach a gift of a full set of kitchen appliances, the refrigerator, the stove, actually the washer and the dryer, dishwasher, microwave. And because of what we do, when we put it in the first house with granite counters, when we sold the house, we didn't take the appliances. We got the money back. We bought a second set of appliances for the second house, and now that's going to the third house, and it'll go to the fourth house. So this building, although it's being used here and it's wonderful what you're doing here, this building is doing something again and again with every house that we work on. Just wanted to say that you're going to see pictures of the two new houses we're working on. And the story's going to be how it's important to be you. About 20 years ago, 30 years ago, anybody heard of Apple computers? When the Mac first came out, they wanted to broaden their appeal, and they wanted to tell you that if you had a Mac, you could be like Edison or Gandhi or Martin Luther King. You could be all these fabulous people. All you needed was a Mac. Well, I'm here to tell you it's actually easier than that. If you have Jesus Christ, and you figure out how to be you, you can be not that star, but you can be whatever it is that you want to be. And the important thing is that you be you. So when you see the reference to the Mac, and it was, if you haven't heard of Mac, you won't get it, but it was the idea that if you had a Mac, you could be that. But the story will make sense to you. If we could show that real quick, and then I'll close this in a prayer. And there purposely is no sound to start. This is my Star Wars rendition. I do believe there is volume now. Families back owning them, and that's all great, but that's not what this is about. The real story here is about the individual having hope for a better tomorrow, the individual realizing they're not in this alone, the individual grasping their power to change this world, and the individuals coming together to affect change. About 30 years ago, a pretty well-known company inadvertently relieved me and many of us of our responsibility to change our world. It was their Think Different campaign where they showed some pretty well-known and exceptional people who had changed the world, people who I could never aspire to be. I came away thinking if only I was different,
not like me, that I needed to change and then I too could change this world. That wasn't the point then, and it's not our point now. Our message and the real reason I need your help is because we all can change the world. All you need to do is be you. The you that wants things to be better. The you that feels better about yourself when you help others. The you that is already different. And you will change this world. And of course, having a Mac could help. Here's to you, the crazy ones, the misfits, the rebels, the troublemakers, the round pegs in the square holes, the ones who see things differently, rule followers or not, concerned with the status quo or not. We may not understand you or agree with you, but we can't ignore you. Because there is power in being you. Your desire to make a difference, the joy you feel when you give, the uniqueness that is you. And while some see you as lost or idealistic, we see you. It is you that will change this world for the better. Be you. Thanks for watching this far, and as I close, I don't want you to leave thinking we're something special, or only if you were like us, we too could change the world. We are no different than you. There is one more piece to this puzzle, though. It's much easier when we play nice. We have so much in common, so much to celebrate, and so much to do. And since we all want things to be better, let's come together. That means neighborhood groups, churches, nonprofits, businesses, city services, government offices, as well as individuals. We're talking collaborations, partnerships, and cooperatives. We look forward to transforming our world together.
The point of the book of James to me is that we, all of us, in our everyday lives, with our everyday gifts and interests and passions, can make a difference by being ourselves. That we don't need to look to the Bible and their great miracles as if we are less than, and that we can't be, in hopes and wait that God someday will anoint you to be and perform that miracle, because the point is, what James has shown us is you are performing that miracle every day, that you struggle with what it means to be a Christian, which is to be a servant, which is as simple as holding a door open when somebody enters, going away on a week-long mission trip, or perhaps going somewhere to move a mountain. I don't know. But don't wait for that opportunity, because as James shows us, that opportunity comes every moment of every day. Thank you.
Sorry. So I'm going to invite the band to come back up, and we just want to say thank you for being here, first of all. It's always good to have you with us. And what we're going to do in just a moment, we're going to receive an offering as we sing our last song. And one of the things that we'd like to do, as we normally do when Tim is here, we receive an offering to benefit Reach as well. So if you'd like to make a donation to Reach today, you can do that with the blue envelopes that are in the back of the chairs. Also, we have it set up so that if you use the PushPay app or if you log onto our website, you can get to a place where you'll be able to make a gift to Reach right there. It's listed in the funds that you can drop down and give to. So we encourage you to do that to continue to support this work that we've been involved in from the very beginning. But let's take a moment now. Let's take a moment to give thanks and pray for Tim, and then we'll sing our closing song. Lord, we give you thanks for all that you've done for us. We give you thanks for the opportunity that we have to be connected with Tim and be connected with Reach and be connected with the work that he's doing. Lord, we share so much of the same values and the philosophy as to what it means to help people, what it means to put ourselves in someone else's shoes, to listen to their stories, to get to know them. Not only that we come with the idea that we can do some good, but the idea that the way that we do that good, the relationship that we have, the way that we carry out the work that you've given us to do in this world is every bit as important. And we pray that all of us, as we go out into this world, might continue to be ourselves, to live according to the example that you've given us in Jesus and in James, and to use our gifts for your glory. We pray all these things in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our sins,
as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Mate, will you lead us?
After you give, feel free to stand with us. Chris is going to lead this one.
In our lives, we all have pain, we all have sorrow, but if we are wise, we know that there's always tomorrow.
Lean on me when you're not strong, and I'll be your friend, I'll help you. Just call on me, brother, when you need a hand. We all need somebody to lean on. I just might have a problem that you'll understand. We all need somebody to lean on. Lean on me when you're not strong, and I'll be your friend. I'll help you. Understand, we all need somebody to lean on. If there is a load you have to bear that you can't carry, I'm right up the road, I'll share your load if you just call me. Call me when you need a friend. Somebody to lean on.
Y'all do need somebody to lean on. James has shown us that he is ready to be leaned on. But I'll tell you a quick secret. If you don't lean on others and ask for help, there's nothing for them to do. And that's where the true joy comes from. So don't forget also to ask your friends, your people that are here, for help. Watch over, protect us, bring us back together again next week, and we'll share the stories of how we've leaned and how we've picked others up. In your name, amen.